and opinions.
Good evening, folks. I'm Sean the Fort Chop Forker. We're going live, Sasquatch Experience. Here we go.
The views and opinions expressed by the guests of Sasquatch Experience do not necessarily reflect the opinion of the hosts, sponsors, or affiliates of the Sasquatch Experience. As always, listener discretion is advised.
911, what are you reporting?
We got someone or something crawling around out here.
Does a legend walk among us, lurking in the forests of our world?
Did you see what it was? Was it a person or an animal or?
I can't tell. All I know is that my sensor light came on and I just happened to glimpse and see this thing running across the yard. A good-sized man or something. It looks like a man. I don't know what it was.
For over 15 years, we've talked with scientists, researchers, investigators, and witnesses, trying to gain insight and proof around the existence of this mysterious entity.
Jesus Christ, you better... Sure. See ya!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him. Uh-oh.
Okay, hang on.
He's right...
Is he in your yard, sir?
Yeah, God, he's big.
Okay, what's he doing in your yard?
He's looking at me.
Join us as we continue into the investigation of the Sasquatch Experience. Well, here we are. It's Monday night. It's that time of the week again. Sasquatch Experience in Baker's squeaky chair. He's James Baker. That's Vance Nesbitt, Henry May. And our guest tonight from BigfootSouth.com, the author of Bigfoot South, Mr. Chester Moore. Chester, thanks for joining us tonight here on the show.
Well, thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Folks, Chester's not new to the Bigfoot field. He's been around for a long time, just like myself. We started off as younger men, with a little less gray and a little less facial hair, but Chester's taken it to actually get into wildlife journalism and really made a career out of all this. Aside from the cryptozoology part, Chester, you've really turned this into quite an adventure for yourself.
Yeah, I started doing this when I was 19, the wildlife journalism part, meaning writing for, back then, newspapers, but magazines, written books, radio shows, podcasts, and doing lectures all around the nation and the world. I love wildlife, fishing, and hunting and conservation. And the Bigfoot thing fits in the middle of that because it involves the mysterious. And as a journalist, I mean, that's kind of what we like to do, is chase stories. And this is a pretty big one.
Yeah, it's a pervasive story, that's for sure. One that has not been solved. Regardless of how many people say it's a hoax or it doesn't exist, Chester, they just can't. As much as we can't prove it, they can't disprove it either.
Yeah, I think that's the thing. I heard it said one time that all it takes is one sighting to be real, one account to be real for this to be a real phenomenon. And I always try to keep that in the back of my mind when I listen to people telling their stories. And, you know, and you're researching, I think if there's just one that was real, this is still the biggest wildlife story in the history of the world.
Yeah, I think that's a John Green quote.
It probably is. I read everything he ever wrote. I mean, Sasquatch the Apes Among Us is my basic guide to the Bigfoot world still to this day. So,
well, it's the book that got me hooked. I was 9 when I read that book, Chester, and it created it put me in that space that, man, this is something I really need to pursue. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, as you even state in your book, at that point in time, we just thought this was something that, you know, existed in the Pacific Northwest, right? It didn't. Yeah. It wasn't a nationwide or worldwide phenomena. The information wasn't out there like it is today. Mm-hmm. And until I read his book and I read the chapter Eastern Action and realized that sightings were happening in my home state of Pennsylvania, mm-hmm. that really kind of whet the appetite for me to really get going. So I started my field work, you know, research early. Back when the internet was in its infancy, there was the virtual internet Bigfoot conference, right? And places you could connect, I guess, a little bit, maybe not as safe as the internet today. I don't want to say that, but it was a different time. But the information just wasn't there like it is today. And that's really changed.
Yeah, for sure. The information thing has gone into hyperspace. And I remember just thinking that, you know, even like Grover Krantz, and I talk about this in my population dynamics chapter in Bigfoot South, he gave Bigfoot population estimate by acreage. And he only mentioned, you know, Oregon, California, Washington and British Columbia. You know, he mentioned the Pacific Northwest. And so when you think about that, and you have guys who are like the apex guy at the time. But for me, it was the legend of Boggy Creek that turned me on to the idea, because I'm a pretty smart little kid and I'm looking at a map and Falco, Arkansas is right on that corner of Texas, Louisiana, Arkansas. And I'm like, hey, if that thing's a Bigfoot, why wouldn't there be one over here in the Lone Star State? So it always had at the back of my mind, they might be here, but it took a while. It just seemed that Bigfoot was there and they couldn't be here. And if it was here, it might be something else. I mean, that was kind of the early thought process.
Right. I mean, it was kind of evolved into its own creature. You had the skunk ape in Florida, mm-hmm. right? Was it mm-hmm. a derivative of that? And
yeah.
And I mean, in your book also, you have a chapter dedicated to feral apes, the primate population, which Baker, that's kind of what you've based a lot of your Sasquatch theory on, right? So you address it. It is a good book, folks. Bigfootsouth.com. You can pick up a copy. I got mine a couple weeks ago. It's a good read. It's not voluminous. It's the perfect length, Chester, for the reader. That's and I think that's important too. We can't all be John Greens, right? And write.
And I don't want to be. I think about poor John Green writing that book before the internet, and right. all of the interviews he had to either call someone or go to their house. And so my thing is to give it in digestible form that's going to entertain people and be fun to read. It's going to have a message of, you know, maybe some unique things that a lot of people aren't talking about. And then also tie it into the love of nature that we have, you know. So that was kind of my theory on doing the book.
So, Jester, you got Sasquatch, the Apes Among Us. Was there a personal encounter of yours that sparked your interest in Sasquatch?
Yeah, you know, like I got into it when I was real little. I mean, I'm 50, so this was in the era of Sid and Marty Krofft, Bigfoot and Wild Boy. This was in the era of the Patterson-Gimlin image being everywhere, and then the Legend of Boggy Creek. And my dad had a copy of the Argosy magazine that had the Patterson-Gimlin, you know, picture on the cover and the whole expose on it. And I remember seeing that and then the Legend of Boggy Creek, and I was so into it. But I had an encounter it's the very first part of the book that I didn't realize was most likely a Bigfoot creature until years later. But it all connected the dots for me when me and my dad were rabbit hunting on my aunt's property. It's legal to hunt rabbits at night with a little headlamp in Texas. And we were down this creek bottom. I had my little Sears in a single shot 410. My dad had a 12 gauge. My aunt and uncle were walking the other side of the property. We would hunt and just split the property and meet down on this creek bottom and kind of cover the whole property. And this thing was letting out this sound that was unlike anything. I mean, I was, you know, it was like 10 or 11. I never heard anything like that in the wild or actually on television. It was bizarre. I was like, Dad, what is that? And I noticed everybody around me who were adults with bigger caliber weapons were nervous. And that must be one of Uncle Bill's bulls hung up in the fence. And I'm like, well, why don't we go help it out? Nah, we better get out of here, you know? And this thing was going nuts. It was vile sound, you know? So I kept bugging my dad and bugging my dad. He goes, well, you know, it might be a bear, because bears at the time were extirpated from this part of Texas, but Louisiana had a remnant population on the border. I bought that until I was 20 years old, started working with captive bears. Didn't sound remotely like a bear. So I don't remember a lot of dates, but I remember August the 20th of 2000. And me and my dad and a guy named Bobby Hamilton, who founded the Gulf Coast Bigfoot Research Organization, I went with him on an investigation. And we checked out this place near Livingston, Texas. And not a whole lot happened. We were sitting out around a campfire, basically listening with, you know, devices, listening that night. And we heard this really weird thing, a moan, a really scary moan, actually, at about 10 o'clock over here. And then about midnight, the moan is right here. And then about 2 o'clock in the morning, it's over here. Same kind of sound. But it was one of those things you're like, I don't know. It was kind of far off. We me and Dad had 2 hours to drive home, Bobby an hour, 4 o'clock in the morning, we're done. And we get pack all our crap in the truck. And the same sound me and Dad heard at my aunt's property came out of the bushes. And my dad turns around and looks at me with his eyes like this and goes, "That's what we heard at Ann's property when you were little." And it went crazy. And I had just been in Venezuela like 8 months earlier fishing for peacock bass on a journalistic expedition. And I had messed with a howler monkey. This was a very howler monkey-esque sound. And this thing let out. Whatever reason, I decided that this howler monkey was getting to my nerves. It wouldn't shut up, so I growled at it. And I did one growl, and it did one growl. I did two, it did two. Well, this thing did the same exact thing. I did one, it did one. I did two, it did two. But on the second one, another one called out behind it, grunts. So there were two animals. There were two whatever these things were there. And then on the third, it built itself into a frenzy. And I mean a guttural, deep frenzy. And at the very end was a long yell. And the yell had a growl, but like a scream in the middle of it. It was like both at the same time. And the closest thing I've ever heard to the most of the sounds we heard that night were some of the Sierra sounds that Ron Moore had recorded. Not the talk stuff, but the guttural stuff that gets overlooked. That sound like that. And it was intense. And that moment in my life, I go, this is real. This is real. And I went and spent $2,000 I didn't have on night vision the next morning. So that was kind of what got me into doing the field research part of it, you know. And then it was something I could not look at.
Understand. That had to be something different to experience. You know the sounds that come out of the woods where you live in the area. And to just be struck by a sound that you really can't identify, especially with your background and you know, spending a great deal of your time in the woods as a younger man, I guess even now as an adult, it still gets you. It still triggers that primal instinct of kind of flight or fight of what's going on. Like, I got to get to the bottom of this, but it's scary as hell.
it was really intense. And, I'll never forget my dad going, "That's what we heard at Ann's." So that connected dots through. That told me there was a story. You know, it's 2 hours away from where we heard the other thing, but same region, same habitat, pine forest mixed with hardwood bottoms. And there was a pattern here. And then when the thing sounded kind of howler monkey-esque, and it responded the same way that a howler monkey did 8 months earlier in Venezuela, that told me whatever's making that noise is a primate. Mm-hmm. And so that really made me very much interested, because a pattern had formed, a couple of patterns had formed. And as a journalist, that's what I'm always looking for. That's how you put a story together. So that, and plus just the freaking intensity of it, you know, it was insane. You know, my dad was about my age now. When that happened, and he might have been a few years older. He's about 55, 56 when that happened. And I mean, it freaked him out. You know, like, my dad loved this stuff, but like, he's gone now. But like, if we were out doing research and we heard something, the campfire would get way big all of a sudden. It was like, you know, right? He's the ultimate campfire builder.
Yeah.
But it was one of those things. And it gives you a perspective when you interview someone or talk with someone that's had something that's really intense happen. Mm-hmm. It gives you that perspective to go, okay, I get it. You know, so let's just hear him out.
You know, Chester, from what I'm getting from you, you know, there's two different categories in the Bigfoot research. Mm-hmm. There's the woo, and then there's the apers. I'm putting you in the apers category, and I'm kind of assuming that's where you would go.
You know what? I'm gonna give the honest answer. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think I tell you this. I don't know. I don't know. I think it's flesh and blood real. I'll give you that much. And it's a primate, and it makes a whole lot more ape-like stuff than human. So
That's
probably where I would fall for sure. Yeah. But, you know, do I think there's something extra with these? It could be possible, but from what I experienced, very, very ape-like, primate-like behavior that matches, but not exactly like known primates.
No, but it's similar enough to make that correlation to go – Yeah, it's reasonable to say that, you know, a primate does this type of activity. It's very possible that these creatures do the same similar activity, not exactly, because each animal is different, as well as you would know. You know, there are similarities in other creatures that kind of replicate similar behaviors, but they're a completely different animal altogether.
Exactly.
Henry Baker, questions before I go on?
I have a question for Chester. As far as your position on kill or no kill, are you still pro kill, or have you modified that a bit?
Well, I figured this would come up, but I'll say this. There will not be one proven until there's a dead body somewhere.
Right.
I just don't see it scientifically possible. And the reason I say that is this isn't some subspecies of woodpecker that we know exists. Yeah. This is something that's a paradigm changer. So there will have to be a body, live or dead. Here's my position. I no longer engage in any activity unless it would be self-defense. And there's a couple of reasons behind that. The first was self-preservation. If someone shoots one of these, and if you're listening, think about this, your life may be over. I know people who've shot legal abundant game in Africa and had problems with animal rights people. Think about this. So I just decided it wasn't worth it for me and my family. And the chances of it ever happening were almost zero anyway. So I don't longer engage in that, but I still think that it's going to require a body. I just don't see how it won't.
No, I agree.
I could understand that. I mean, we've had this discussion multiple times. I don't think if a body's found, it's either going to be accidentally.
Sure.
As in I accidentally found the body and then I could prove it because it was there when I came back, or I accidentally hit it with my car. Yep. And I've always believed that it's not going to be a research group or a researcher that finds it. It's going to be some old lady high on Chardonnay driving home, and she hits
probably.
You know, and she tries to Harry and Henderson into the back of the car, and then and then she brings it to some animal. She brings it to some animal shelters, and then it becomes a news story. I don't think it's going to be. And don't get me wrong. I think some of our researchers are phenomenal.
Sure.
But I don't think any of them are ever going to bag a Bigfoot.
Right. You know, I don't know. It probably by chance would just be someone who's hunting and shot one and, and got scared, or a roadkill is probably a pretty high level of that. Or, you know, the chances of one just finding one laying there dead is almost nil, I think. But it would have to be something like a roadkill or somebody shooting one or whatever. Or someone like, in, you know, something raiding someone's chicken coop and they just shoot a bunch of, lob a bunch of shells back there and go the next morning, there's a dead Bigfoot laying there. And what do I have, you know, and, you know, that kind of stuff. And so, yeah, probably so. But I still think it will require more than just a piece of DNA to.
Oh, yeah, there's got to be a whole body. It's
consider it a species, you know, because of what we're dealing with, you know.
Right.
Right. I agree that I think it has to be a civilian discovery instead of a governmental, and I'm not talking federal, I'm talking, you know, local government, municipal government, state government discovery. If it's a civilian discovery of a carcass of whatever sort, even if it's decayed for a period of time, I think that's where most of the evidence will come to the surface. Otherwise, it may just get buried under a governmental umbrella of sorts.
Yeah, you know, and that's a really easy rabbit hole to go into, what's happened with I talk a little bit about it in my book, what could potentially has happened with carcasses and things before. I think if someone does get a carcass, there will be a very short window to make it to media in time before something happens with that thing, you know. I think there's but that's probably the most likely reason for it. I know this. I work with wildlife officials around the globe all the time, and I don't think there are a lot of conspiracies to hide stuff. I just think there is a a narrative that anything that doesn't help us get grants and make us money, or that might be controversial, or that might be controversial to us and cause us heat, we're just going to ignore it. It's not there. You know, I've seen it with mountain lions and other stuff, which is ridiculous because mountain lions are native to much of Canada, all the lower 48 and all the way down to Patagonia. I mean, why wouldn't we admit there are mountain lions east of, you know, I-35 in Dallas, Texas, you know? But it's so if that can be heat and controversy, come on, man. You know, an 8-foot tall primate that looks kind of like a dude, that's going to cause an entirely different level of that.
I feel attacked.
Yeah.
Chester, being in wildlife journalism, has the Bigfoot and being attached to Bigfoot impacted any of your professional endeavors?
You know, it's a great question because I was nervous to talk about it in the beginning, you know, and I still don't go around like I'm not, you know, I don't preach the gospel of Bigfoot. I just still talk about it, but I haven't had any reduction in my career. You know, I mean, any less pay I'm making just because the business I work in is shrinking, but I've never lost a job that I'm aware of because of it. I'm still doing what I was doing. And I think some of it's because I'm a relatively sane, rational guy talking about this stuff. I'm not talking talking about meeting the ghost of Richard Nixon and Elvis in a UFO talking to Bigfoot. Right. You know, I'm talking about what people are seeing, you know. But I did have a funny story about this. I've only had a couple of people in my business bring it up. I've had a lot of readers bring it up. Like I'll be at a sports show, a fishing show, and I have a lot of people ask about it there. And I had a few jackasses ask a couple of dumb questions, you know, that's expected. But I had a guy, walk up to me one time and say, hey, man, we found a Bigfoot tracks out behind the hotel if you want to go put some plaster. And this is before I was walking with the Lord. So I gave him some Stone Cold Steve Austin hand signatures in his face, literally, and walked off. And the guy follows me into the elevator and I'm going to do what he want. I don't, you know. I'm not someone who operates in dishonor. I don't go, even somebody I like radically disagree with, I would never like go mess with them or dishonor just the culture I've created for our family, you know? Anyway, he gets in and he starts telling me, I don't know about no Bigfoot, but I saw this weird thing in South Newton County, Texas. And I'm like, where? Cause that's where I done most of my research. And he lived in Dallas, which is 4.5-5 hours away. So he tells me a story of going to his buddy's deer lease and opening weekend in southern part of Newton County and coming across this sign that says Nichols Creek. And on the cover of Bigfoot South, there's this grayish looking Bigfoot and there's a little sign that says Nichols Creek. There's a reason for that. So I said, come on, keep talking. And he said, we left about midnight to get there about 5:30 at camp and get ready to go out and eat breakfast and get ready to go out to the stands. And I just woken up and I'm in the passenger and I look over and standing on the white line about to cross the road is this thing that's about 5.5-6 feet tall, gray, and it had hair all over except on its face. And the face kind of looked like maybe like some kind of an ape human look thing. And I said, hold on a second. Bigfoot's funny and mockable to you. What the heck do you think you saw? Right. And I'll never forget the answer. It's the greatest answer I may have ever gotten in my life. I thought about being some kind of weird wolf. I said, so we have bipedal wolves walking around and that's cool, but Bigfoot's mockable. Now, what I didn't tell him was I already had two other reports in front of the same sign over a course of 10 years by people. One of them was before the internet really was a factor of a gray colored Bigfoot. And as I'm finishing Bigfoot South, shameless plug, BigfootSouth.com. It's for sale now. A lady sent me a message on Facebook who lives in Newton County. Thanks, sir. And she wanted me to come check her property out. And at the end of her message, I mean, I was on a trip. I couldn't get to it. The very last message, do you think it's possible there are gray Bigfoots? And a relative of hers saw a gray-colored Bigfoot crossing a road, not on the Nichols Creek sign, but about 3 miles as a crow flies in the same set of woods. So pattern formed. And that was probably my biggest story of anyone in the industry saying anything. And, you know, like I think some people, a lot of people into Bigfoot are – so blown away by the fantastic nature that they just don't know how to act around people. They don't know that people just want to do whatever. I let people bring Bigfoot up to me. I don't have to. Because they flip the channels too long, they're going to see my mug on some Bigfoot show. They run those things all the time. And people are going to talk about it. So I talk about it at that level, but I don't, it's not the most important thing in the world. I mean, I know that's going to hurt some feelings, but there are other things that are more important than Sasquatch on the planet. And I love the topic and I love to talk about it, but I don't get up in people's face about it, you know?
I have to commend you on that. Two things. I think your answer to the question was brilliant. You know,
thank you.
I'm a sane person, right? I'm a professional person myself, Chester. People know I do Bigfoot.
Sure.
Like you said, it's not the driving factor in my life. It's one hell of a good hobby. I love it. But in my day to day, anybody that's ever mocked has always sat down and left with a better understanding of why I research, right? It's an educational tool. It might be funny, haha, to them until you talk and find out why. When you talk to that everyday person, a doctor, lawyer, who had a sighting of something they can't explain, it's not so funny to people anymore.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's a great haha. That's an incredible point, Sean, because another reason that I continue to do this is the work that me and my wife do with hurting children. We have a ministry outreach. Our goal is to bring the love of Christ to hurting kids through wildlife encounters. And we have done numerous Bigfoot expeditions. And I don't want to hear some high and mighty elitist, you know, squashing down the idea of Bigfoot because they have lesser brain cells or because they have some kind of ego. And hurting that little kid who dreams big and wants to go look for something to interest him. That's where it makes me mad. And so I think that this topic obviously probably represents a lot of the child in all of us, which is a good thing. I mean, I hadn't grown up yet, you know?
Right.
And, you know, I don't want to. I've seen it. It sucks. And I pay my bills and I do what I got to do, but I still have a yearning for this. And I think that's a great point about when you sit down and talk to people, that most people will at least go, oh, that's kind of interesting, you know, or what happens. I've noticed this too. I had the one guy who, you know, I have had a couple of people like just pull me aside at like a fishing or sport hunting show. Right. And they'll go, and I know when they pull me aside, what they're about to ask, I just know. And they'll tell me some story they would never dream going public with. You know, like, I don't know if you think this is real, but I saw this big shaggy thing about 7 feet tall with reddish brown hair crossing the road in front of, you know, wherever. And I'm like, yeah, that's very interesting. Get details from them. And I think sometimes us treating other people with respect about it's just as important, you know?
Absolutely. And guys, Baker, hold that thought. We have to take our break. It is 9:28. Folks, you're listening to the Sasquatch Experience, Monday, April 1st. This is not an April Fool's joke. You're listening to the Sasquatch Experience with Chester Moore, Sean Forker, James Baker, Vance Nesbitt, Henry May, and we'll be back right after this.
News team, assemble!
Ah, yes, the day after the Easter Bunny leaves the eggs and candy, Studio 401 smells like a sulfur pit. Thanks, Lenny. Oh, it's not you. Oh, okay. Can you take it to the bathroom and turn the fan on, please? I'd much rather smell of cabbage right now than the stink pit it smells like in here. I apologize to everybody. This is the Bigfoot Bullhorn. Happy Monday night to you all, right here on the Sasquatch Experience. Well, hopefully that's a problem that's going to get handled. Anyway, let's do what we're here for, you know, on the Bullfoot Bullhorn. The BFRO, or as I like to say, Bufro, had a investigation of a recent sighting of a Sasquatch-like creature north of Centralia, Washington State. According to one witness who was riding motorcycles with his friend and 3.5-year-old son on a motorcycle. Okay. I bet he had his own motorcycle. Back on February 4th, the group spotted something running across the ridgetop about 0.5 mile away. quote, "It was very large, human-shaped," the man reported to the BFRO. "There was one color, tan/brown. Well, then that's two colors, but moving across a very rugged terrain, making a beeline for the trees. The three of them watched the figure for about 30 seconds before it went out of sight. It moved so fluently with little arm movement, unlike a human being running," the witness said. "It easily was 10 feet tall for us to be able to see it from that distance." The witness reported the sighting to the BFRO on February 8th. Investigator Scott Taylor followed up with his investigation. Taylor said that that area is well known for Bigfoot sightings and seems to be traveled corridor between the Capitol Forest and Bald Hill area. "Based on the description of the way the creature walked and its speed across the terrain, I believe that these three witnesses were fortunate to see a Sasquatch." Another investigator, we all know, Matt Moneymaker, also talked to the witnesses at length. Moneymaker noted that Fester's hobby is motorcycle trail riding, which has allowed him to explore a lot of backcountry. He has observed large animals and humans near and far while riding around the hills over the years. "This figure was observed at about a half a mile distance, but with that unobscured view as it moved along an open area, both he and the riding companions were certain they were watching something that was upright and roughly 10 feet tall." Now, Moneymaker said, if the figure was human, the witness and his friend would have figured that out. The figure they saw was simply too big to be human. Lenny, please. Again, I apologize for my brother's irrehensible behavior. The investigator points out that wildlife naturally transits between the mountains of the Olympic Peninsula and then the Cascade Mountains. And this is the first Sasquatch sighting listed for Lewis County on the BFRO website. When we come back, a very disappointing announcement.
You're listening to the Bigfoot Bullhorn right here on the Sasquatch Experience.
Do you have feelings of inadequacy? Do you suffer from shyness? Do you sometimes wish you were more assertive? If you answered yes to any of these questions, ask your doctor or pharmacist about tequila. Tequila is the safe, natural way to feel better and more confident about yourself and your actions. Tequila can help ease you out of your shyness and let you tell the world that you're ready and willing to do just about anything. You'll notice the benefits of tequila almost immediately, and with a regimen of regular doses, you can overcome any obstacles that prevent you from living the life you want to live. Shyness and awkwardness will be a thing of the past, and you'll discover many talents you never knew you had. Stop hiding and start living with tequila. Tequila may not be right for everyone. Women who are pregnant or nursing should not use tequila. However, women who wouldn't mind nursing or becoming pregnant are encouraged to try it. Side effects may include dizziness, nausea, vomiting, incarceration, erotic lustfulness, loss of motor control, loss of clothing, loss of money, loss of virginity, delusions of grandeur, table dancing, headache, dehydration, dry mouth, and a desire to sing karaoke and play all night rounds of strip poker, truth or dare, and naked twister. Warning, the consumption of alcohol may make you think you're whispering when you're not, is a major factor in dancing like a retard, may cause you to tell your friends over and over again that you're in love with them, also may cause you to think you can sing. Alcohol may lead you to believe that ex-lovers are really dying for you to telephone them at 4 a.m. Alcohol may make you think you can logically converse with members of the opposite sex without spitting. It may create the illusion that you are tougher, smarter, faster, and better looking than most people, and it may lead you to think people are laughing with you. Alcohol may cause pregnancy, and it also may be a major factor in getting your ass kicked. So what are you waiting for? Stop hiding and start living with tequila. Tequila!
What? Are you kidding me? I understand that it's April Fool's Day, but come on now. October 4th and 5th of this year, the Hinobia Bigfoot Festival and Conference in Hinobia, Oklahoma, has been canceled. and it was canceled by Artie Carnes and the Kiamichi Mountain Christian Mission. You know, at some point on the Sasquatch Experience, I'm sure we will talk about the Hinobia events that happened that created this festival and conference to continue talking about it. I do not understand what the politics is involved here, but unfortunately, this is not an April Fool joke. Thanks again for listening to this edition of the Bigfoot Bullhorn right here on the Sasquatch Experience. And of course, as always,
until we meet again,
keep your toes in the mud.
We here at the Sasquatch Experience do not condone the use of tequila, as once again, our editor must have fell asleep at the wheel tonight. Good evening, folks. Welcome back, Sasquatch Experience. I'm Sean Forker, James Baker, Henry May, Vance Nesbitt, and our guest, Chester Moore. Guys, we had a great first half of the show. Vance, thank you for that entertaining Bigfoot bullhorn tonight. I appreciate that, buddy.
Mm-hmm. And Artie's in the bathroom, as we
say. Well, that's where Artie belongs. He was really stinking up the joint tonight. Hey, that the Hinobia Bigfoot conference, that's news to me. I'm glad you brought that up.
Actually, so that may be an April Fool's joke. I was one of the speakers and got a Facebook message about a week ago that it may still be going on. So
I hope it does because we're
Chester,
going
keep us posted.
18 years.
I'm gonna speak this year, and I got an email. It looks like it's a good chance it's still gonna go on. They didn't give much more details than that, but that's a little caveat I can add right there.
You go. Yeah. Breaking news right here after the bullhorn. So thank you, Chester. See, we bring you up to the latest, folks. We keep our commitments to you on that. So Baker, before we went to break, you're going to ask a question. Go ahead, pick up where you left off, buddy.
Well, I think it was more of a statement and kind of what he was already talking about. He said, you know, that's the one thing, you make a valid point about people you meet about the Bigfoot, the people that make fun of you and things like that, or try to make life more difficult. The opposite of what I see a lot is, and I saw some this weekend and I've seen some at other conferences, are I call them almost street preachers. Like they're just like that. You have to believe exactly what they say, or they just keep jamming it down your throat. This has got to be a stick formation. And see where I'm like, no, I don't. And they mad. And those are the people that make it harder for us to research. You know, you run into a lot of those?
I'm a very non-drama person. I don't mind confrontation. I don't ever look for it because I look at like this scene on Tombstone, my favorite movie. You know, Johnny Ringo wants to fight Wyatt Earp. He says, I'm not going to fight you today. There's no money in it. You know, so unless there's a cause for me to argue with someone or like, hey, man, this stick formation has to be two Bigfoot setting up a territorial corridor. Cool. Glad you believe that. Bye. I don't really fight it because I don't care. Honestly, I mean, if they want to think but the ones that get in your face about it, I'm like, it's called delete and block. Because if they're going to be that, my theory is if someone is going to be so dogmatic, not only dogmatic, but like intense and in your face about something that we haven't even proved exists on a scientific level yet, to where they're like in your face and you suck because you don't believe in it, delete, block. I don't need that in my life. That's just kind of how I live, you know? I'll be nice to everybody, but if you become get in my face about something that's stupid, bye, see ya, sayonara, you know?
Right. And to take off what you were saying, Baker, like when you've been here a long time, you know, these aren't new conversations that have been had. These conversations are going on from the beginning, and nobody's proven anything yet.
Exactly.
To Chester's point, like, but we've heard people trying to make hay out of this stick formation since we started. You know, really, someone brought them up. I like Chester, before we went on the air, it was funny how, like, up until like 25 years ago, nobody was talking about things like wood knocks and stuff. And all of a sudden, somebody says it, takes it on, and it becomes the gospel of behavior for these things. But when you go back, and I don't recall it now, the sounds we've had for forever, but like the tree knocking, like, I don't recall that in any of the early literature of of the books. I could be wrong. It wouldn't be the first time, but I don't recall that. Henry, do you recall when tree knocking became a thing?
I'm trying to remember. I don't believe I ever read about any book before like 1995.
Yeah. I don't remember it being like Bigfoot Casebook or, you know, Lauren Coleman's books or any of that early stuff like that. It may have been in there and we missed it. I mean, I think it's good chance it's part of the phenomenon. I've certainly heard that myself, not a lot, but I've heard things that were like, that wasn't a limb cracking, you know? But that and like just certain other things being in the vernacular of the phenomenon has made it a lot harder to research because everyone knows they know the talking points. It's like, they no longer just say, you know, hey, I saw this thing. You know, I was in my deer stand and this thing come and stood behind this tree about 75 yards out and kept looking out behind the tree. Then I just saw this shadow move through. It had this certain shape. Now you get, well, you know, I found this travel corridor and there was a stick pointing this way and another stick going this way. And then at that night, I heard this particular sound in the background and I heard a whoop and I heard the samurai chatter. And, you know, it's hard to sort through all of that so much. Because of, it's like you can, as an interviewer and you guys as well, I can really easily, if I wanted to, guide a conversation somewhere, you know, you can, and sometimes just better to just let people talk. And I've even had a particular situation where someone was going like, I mean, they give me every single thing you've ever heard of on a Bigfoot television program in like 3 minutes, you know? And I just said, okay, let's just start. Let's leave all that stuff out. What did you see? Because it was a sighting thing they saw. And they told me this thing that they saw. I said, where did this other stuff come into this equation of the sighting? And they were like, well, I just remembered stuff that I had seen in that woods and things like that. And that can be valid. I said, but let's stick with the one thing we know for sure is related to your sighting. And that's what you saw with your eyes. And then they just kind of calm down about it. You know, I think sometimes people are they're so nervous about telling the story that they want to fill in the blanks with anything that might give them backup evidence to a Bigfoot researcher, you know?
Well, I think you make a really good point with that, Chester. And as we've talked about this in the past, is oftentimes as investigators, researchers, are we leading the witness to where we want them to go, not are we listening for where they need to take us. Mm-hmm. And like you said, pulling back and slowing that down, it's a fundamental issue I've had for a long time. And I've seen it in countless situations where I've been along with somebody interviewing someone where they're giving the narrative to the witness without even realizing it. Like you're coaching them on, and there's not a lot of integrity to that, right? Rather, it's done maliciously or not, you kind of diluted your data pool.
Yeah, it can be a tough area in something like this. Yeah. It's not like there's an Associated Press guidebook to Bigfoot interviewing, you know?
Right.
You know, like I have when I started off in my journalism career, this is kind of what we do, you know? So I just take basic from my, and I'm sure I've made mistakes doing the same stuff, you know? Certainly not intentionally, but I try to always kind of just bring things back to what happened. And then we can ask, we can look at other things. And sometimes it's not everything people see is a Bigfoot, you know, and not everything they see is a guy in a suit, and not everything is a hoax or is a lie. There's other things people see. And I'll give you an interesting one, because in the other more, I guess you could call mainstream work that I do a lot about like exotic wildlife, changing the landscape of America that's out there so much in the exotic world that is changing. And a guy told me this thing in Central Texas, and he was out on a Bigfoot expedition in an area that was kind of unknown for Bigfoot. I kind of had some, I had some intel on the basic area within about 45 minute drive from there. We never heard a lot. And all of a sudden he talks about this thing that came up and it moved in a weird fashion. You could see it. Cause if you ever use night vision goggles, it's not like you see on the movies, you know, and this thing really big, about 6 feet tall, and it had these weird, he said, it almost looked like these two horn things off of it. And he said, when it left this area, it just like, bam, it jumped and left. And I said, you know, there's something that's becoming more common on ranches in that particular area, and it's a red kangaroo. And a red kangaroo can get about 5 feet tall, and they're bound when they move, and they're out there, and they escape fences, and I know of stuff like that as well. And the guy went back because he said it looked like horns, and it moved really weird, and he even mapped it out and found there was a property within a half mile that had red kangaroos.
So crazy.
He thought it might. Well, he wasn't saying it was a Bigfoot. He didn't know. He thought it might have been some kind of other cryptid, you know. But it was a Bigfoot expedition. I'm not saying he for sure saw a red kangaroo, but when we narrowed that down and there was a place nearby, it made sense, you know. So people see other stuff too out there that may or may not be Bigfoot.
Did he think he's seen a jackalope?
I have not seen a jackalope.
No, no jackalopes. No.
Although in Du Bois, Wyoming, they have the largest taxidermied jackalope of all time, and it is in a store, and it's all real rabbit fur. And PETA would hate it because they must have killed 350 rabbits to make this thing. You know what I mean? Right. It was like, you know.
You know, yeah. Chester, that brings me back to. Because I'm old enough and being a kid in the 1970s and in the morning eating breakfast, getting ready for school as a little kid, and mom would have the AM radio on to the most popular news radio station in the Chicago area. And there was a report of a kangaroo looking cryptid that was running through the area. And people freaked out. That's not something that exists here. And it terrified me as a kid, but it terrified a lot of the residents in the area going, what type of creature looks like a kangaroo that's in the area in the here? I'm sure, you know, now looking hindsight 2020, yeah, somebody could have brought, you know, a young kangaroo in and it escaped, you know, its enclosure. Yeah. But boy, let me tell you, the terror that was invoked upon the area, and we're talking, you know, 34 miles, people were terrified of an unknown creature that was in the area, and it was like
they got the weightlifter biceps in the vein that runs through their arms.
They're jazzed.
How about it?
The first time I did, we do a program that grants wildlife encounters for children with a critical illness, parental loss, girls have been through trafficking, kids dealing with depression, and we had some kids that wanted to meet some kangaroos, and there was a guy who had red kangaroos, and his females all had joeys in their pouch at the time. The females you could walk up to and pet, and you know, and they would eat out of your hand. The kids were freaking out. Well, there was one big male in there, but he was way off, you know, like an acre or so away. When the big male rolled up, he showed those guns to us. And I was like, I'm not going out like this, man. The guy goes, it's time to roll, you know. And so that's, there you go. I mean, they're pretty intimidating.
They have claws.
And they stand as tall as you are. I'm not going to get into a fist fight or a kick fight with you. I'll choose another way to die. Thanks.
Yeah. And vocalizations are something that I have an issue to my podcast, Dark Outdoors. And I interviewed Ron Moorhead a little bit on it. And I went through different sounds that are known animals. And one of the things is people in the eastern half of the U.S., a lot of them don't realize there are major, there have been major elk restoration programs in Kentucky and Virginia and Tennessee and North Carolina and all these states. And people are not used to hearing rutting elk bugling. You know, that's pretty much something people in Colorado and Montana, Wyoming, all the way to the Pacific Northwest. So if someone at their campsite has a bull they don't know lives there, elk bugling by their tent, they may think it's a Sasquatch. You know?
Chester, I had a 3:30 in the morning encounter with an elk bugling in our campsite, and about a dozen of us left cutout impressions in our tents scrambling to what the hell that noise was. We knew after the initial shock you know, wore off, because it just happened so sporadically early in the morning, but... it was crazy. And it's wild. I live up in northern PA, and we have, you know, elk herds up this way. And Matt Arner, one of our co-hosts who's not on with us tonight, we were out about 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago now, and we were driving down the old roads, dirt roads, and we just happened to be going by, and I saw something large and fur-covered just out of my peripheral. And I said, "What, Matt, what the hell was that?" And he stops, and we look, and there's five or six elk right alongside the road. Like, we wouldn't even have seen them.
Yeah.
They were so still. I just happened to catch that.
That's
and you're
cool.
talking about massive creatures, man. They are big.
And they got lung power, you know. And,
they do.
In the wildlife conservation world, that I got an elk. There's an elk right behind me. He's a former elk. Or, you know, he's part of an elk. But the incredible animals. There's been great wildlife conservation work to restore them on that part of the world. Matter of fact, I just put in for a non-resident Kentucky elk tag, hoping to get some elk for the Moore family to last us for beef replacement for the next year. We'll see what happens. I think probably 10,000 others are drawn for that tag in Kentucky, but it's, you know, there's all
somebody's got to win.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So like in Bigfoot South, I talk about, you know, you mentioned earlier feral primates and escape animals and things like that. We have in Dilley, Texas, which is south of San Antonio, an established and verified population of Japanese macaques. And my first encounter hearing of those was back when I was in college bow hunting down there. And I was doing what I'm doing now at a much lesser level. And this guy had read my column and invited me to hunt his ranch. And he told me a story at the campfire at night. He goes, you know, a buddy of mine was hunting one morning. He was in a stand and he's in this little valley and it was real quiet. And this crazy growl scream lets out. And it's really close to him. He keeps getting closer and closer. Then he hears something hit the stand. And then a little furry hand reached inside of his opening of the stand.
Oh, Lord. Yeah.
And it was one of those Japanese macaques. He goes, they call them snow monkeys down there. Mm-hmm. And I've gotten numerous pictures that readers have sent me of those things down there sitting on fence post. A guy at his deer feeder, one chased the deer off. He has like a shot of like the deer and then the monkey and then like the monkey by itself. And so you have those rhesus monkeys in Florida. And I did some digging and found out about a place called the Chimp Farm. And there were a couple of those that were in Florida that closed, and the rhesus monkey population escaped from there. Right. What was more interesting wasn't the escape of that. It was the fact they had, and this doesn't happen now, they had orangutans, they had gorillas, and lowland gorillas, I believe, and they had orangutans. And most places outside of AZA zoos, they'll get maybe a gibbon or something like that, but they don't get like the orangs and the gorillas. Mm-hmm. And so, would it have been possible? We know people have encountered these feral monkeys. Would it be possible, like in Florida, for there to have been a few of these out that would make a breeding population or something like that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Actually, that brings up a point I've been saying for years is you look at all these failed zoos, you look at carnivals, you look at NASA, you look at PETA, Let's Go, Bobo the Monkey, in New York, and it moves its way through the Appalachian Trail, comes down to Florida. The swamps between Florida and Texas are ripe with these animals, animals that shouldn't be there, but the conditions are right for them to thrive, and they're going to. And I'm not saying that every one of them is not a Sasquatch, and I'm not saying every one of them has to be, but you make the same valid points are is that we've displaced animals in such a way over the last 50 years in the United States. I'm even before 50 years in the United States, but I would say like from the space race to like I said, is like you look at all those places that were testing animals for different things and somebody let them out or the company went bankrupt and they euthanized them. No, they didn't. They just let them out. Screw that, you know, we had we had a mink farm that 3,000 of them escaped. They're still looking for them. There's some all over, but some of them are slowly moving down. We're probably slowly moving down south because the weather was better. you know,
they didn't escape. They were let out.
Mink are native anyway, so they would just integrate to the population and give the giant population boost to those suckers, you know?
Oh yeah, and they're but like any of these animals that we have, we have people that come home with a boa constrictor or king cobra, and mom goes, no, that's not happening, and lets it out in the yard. And then Florida's full of cobras now.
It gets interesting. And, you know, like I do a lot of research on the Black Panther phenomenon and all that as well. And I don't believe that. I think very few panther sightings or escaped exotics. I don't think they're established. Leopards. I don't think that a circus train crashed. It's always a circus train. Mm-hmm. Apparently, the least safe place to be is on a circus train. They always crash.
Yeah, right? Agreed.
And the entire planet. Agreed. And it happened to have a female black leopard and a male black leopard, and they could survive in the wild, blah, blah, blah. But the difference on the primates is you could have a few young chimpanzees from the 1960s that got out and still be alive. And they have slower reproductive. They're going to be a lot shyer. So a place like the Everglades, Okefenokee Swamp, other areas could definitely have and harbor small breeding populations of, like, you know, chimps, those kind of animals, orangs. And, you know, the Mayaka ape that Lauren Coleman had made famous in his post out of Mayaka in Florida. Man, if I just saw that thing, you know, and I was in the woods or at my house where that lady saw that thing, I wouldn't go, it's a Bigfoot. I go, my God, there's an orangutan in the yard.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And I think maybe she did think it was orangutan. I don't remember now. But so I think you're a great point that there's some of this stuff out there that's different and that doesn't fit the catch-all Bigfoot, you know?
All right.
Mm-hmm. Guys, we've reached that point of the show where it's come to the close. Chester, final thoughts or promotions, things you got going on where the folks can find you and continue to follow you?
Yeah, so one of the things I'm doing, my buddy Paul Fazinski and I and another friend, Seth, are working on a project called Wild Man of the Woods. Go to the Wild Man of the Woods YouTube channel. Incredible, incredible documentaries that are being done there. Got a new one coming out soon. BigfootSouth.com. Get the book Bigfoot South. Also, GlobalBigfoot.com, another website of mine. We've created a thing called the Global Bigfoot Society to help us fund work we're doing with these hurting children doing Bigfoot encounters. And if you sign up for that, you get these four of these really cool cards done in the style of John James Audubon. This website is mainly about everything but Pacific Northwest Bigfoot. They're on there too. It's other cryptids. And the book Bigfoot South is out, BigfootSouth.com, and I will be appearing at the Falk Monster Festival. Come up real excited, talking about feral primates at that particular festival. So excited about that.
Chester, is the book going to be available on Amazon?
Yeah, it will be. It'll be available after the Falk event. I'll have that ready. I've been traveling, a lot of things going to do that, and there will be an audio version as well. That's being recorded in the next couple of weeks.
Oh, cool. Good job.
And thank you guys for having me on, asking killer questions, and I always appreciate the opportunity to talk with like-minded individuals and talk about this fun stuff called Bigfoot.
Yes. No, it's
our pleasure.
Thank you for showing up.
Yep. Well, like I said, it's been many years since we talked, so I was glad to reacquaint and get back together for an episode.
Same here, man. Thank you so much again. I really appreciate it, guys.
It's our pleasure. Folks, Sean Fork, you can find me on all social media platforms. I go by my name. I don't hide behind a pseudonym. Baker, you can find him wherever you find me. Vance, where can folks find you?
They can find me sitting in this chair right here in the northwest suburbs of Chicago, but I'm on Instagram and Facebook.
There you go. And Henry, how about you, buddy?
It's Henry May on Facebook.
He is. And folks, ladies, as Baker says, he's looking for a fifth. One more final shameless promotion. Look at that. Ohio Bigfoot Conference 2024. Matt Pruitt, mm-hmm. Jeff Meldrum, Doug Hijack, Darby Orkut, Cliff Berrickman, and Adam Davies as the MC. And those three handsome gentlemen will be there representing the Sasquatch Experience. We are a sponsor of the conference. Look at that. Look at those handsome faces.
How about it?
Stop by and see us. Awesome. We'll be there. Going to have a good time. We were just at Bill Rigby's conference over the weekend, the Penn, Ohio Paranormal Conference. And, of course, if you missed the announcement Friday, we'll be returning to the Small Town Monsters Fest in June, at the end of June in Canton, Ohio. We're going to do a live podcast. But guys, we're doing something really special for this one. You'll want to come in and join the live podcast. It's going to be a hell of a good time. We're going to put a lot of effort into it. Not that we didn't last year, but it's going to be more of an effort. So, Henry, why don't you go ahead and take us out with those beautiful, beautiful words.
Y'all be good or be good at it.
There you go, folks. Keep on squatching. We'll see you next time.
Thank you, guys.
You've been listening to the Sasquatch Experience. Please rate and review where this podcast has been consumed. To share your experience, visit us on Facebook, our website, or email us, info@sasquatchexperience.com. Keep on squatching.